Stories.
Hi, I'm the girl that lost.
Late breaking, the first words from 11-year-old Nadia Bloom talking to 911. Rescued after four nights, missing and alone in the woods and the marsh. West 2 with the man who found her and the family members elated that he did. Plus, the search for Haley Cummings. Dive teams called into action after a fresh new tip. West 2 is on the scene with breaking news coverage. West 2 News 10 to 10 starts right now. Right now, Nadia's alive. The miraculous end to the four-night search. Her rescuer calls it an act of God. Tonight, it's no doubt heaven on earth for her family.
In Russian, Nadia means hope, something her family and her community refuse to give up. Good evening. I'm Martha Sigalski.
I'm Jim Payne. That determination paid off with the ultimate phone call this morning, the one that said Nadia is okay.
Late breaking right now, the 911 call placed by Nadia and the man who found her.
Got her. I got Nadia. I'm holding her right now. Yeah, she's okay. She's got bites all over her. She's got some scratches. She's very lucid. She has no major injuries, just exposure.
Hi. Nadia, I'm the girl that lost.
Okay. Nadia, are you okay? You're not hurt in any way?
An apple?
Certainly an apple. I want an apple.
I brought an apple just for you, Nadia.
Thank you.
Less than 3 hours later, Nadia was carried out of the dense woods and rushed to the hospital.
The man on that call is James King, a volunteer working alone. He knows Nadia from their church. King told dispatchers on the 911 call he walked into the woods in Winter Springs from State Road 417. He trudged in more than a half mile in knee-deep water and then made the stunning discovery. You're looking at a map of the search area. Rescue teams had already looked through all the land that was highlighted in yellow. They had plans to move into Zone 13 in the near future, but James King ignored orders against private searches and found the girl on his own.
Tonight, doctors described Nadia's condition as remarkable, considering she just spent four nights alone, a testament to her strength. West 2 captured this image before she was loaded into the ambulance. She's waving, seeming to tell everyone she's just fine. Seconds later, a quick glimpse of her face. Her eyes are open, and she's conscious. An alert.
A mix of joy, disbelief, and relief all at once for Nadia's friends and family. West 2 spoke with the little girl's father and uncle moments after the rescue.
Just thank God when you get home and just give him the praise for this. Thank him for this. You know, it's just amazing. I just, you know, things don't always turn out this way. You're so blessed.
Dreams absolutely come true. You've got to maintain your faith. And be as strong as you can. There's lots of stories of people coming out alive, and this is one of them, and there's stories that go the other way. But this is just the biggest miracle you could possibly hope for.
Nadia's mother, father, sister, and grandfather were all there to greet her as she was carried out of the woods.
A man who was with her every step of the way, James King. He's a man the police are now calling a hero.
And Nadia's rescuer says a higher power led him to the missing little girl. West 2's Craig Lucy is live tonight at Metro Church in Winter Springs, where friends and family celebrated, and James King talked about his heroics. Craig?
Jim, we spoke to James King for about 15 minutes. He was joined by a couple hundred other people here at Metro Church as they celebrated Nadia being found safe. But they all really wanted to hear from James King, the man who set out early this morning shouting Nadia's name, and then he said he heard her voice.
Praying, every one of your prayers were heard, you know, not just mine.
45-year-old father of five, James King, says he wasn't going to give up on the search for Nadia Bloom.
Got up in the morning, you know, I taped up my boots and I did everything, sharpened my machete last night and got everything ready this morning. I was out there as soon as the sun was up.
While King set out by himself, dozens of other searchers were not far away, but he says he headed towards the swamp off State Road 417.
Most of the time I was either walking on logs or wading, and typically ankle deep up to knee deep.
King wasn't quiet.
As I was walking through the woods, I would call out, Nadia, Nadia. So then I got a little further and I said, Nadia, and I heard, what? So I zoomed in on where it was coming from and then started calling out to you, it's Mr. King, I'm coming.
The next 12 minutes were captured in this 911 call.
The Lord told me where to find her. You're not kind of want to send somebody the way I came.
Nadia takes the phone briefly.
Hi, I'm the girl that lost.
You're a brave girl.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, Nadia. Nadia, can I take your picture?
Sure.
This one is so that you can show how God protected you.
James King says Nadia was very calm. She still had her backpack on with a book in it about exploring the outdoors. No shoes, though.
I was surprised at what great shape she was in. She had dots from the top of her head to the bottom of her feet, from mosquito bites, small scrapes. There were no major cuts. And she's just looking up at me like, okay, here you are. And
King said he asked Nadia where she had been. She said that I'd been exploring and I simply got lost. He also says that she never seemed like she was very afraid. Reporting live in Winter Springs, Seminole County, Craig Lucy, West 2 News on CW 18.
Craig, thanks. Nadia's rescue came even as police worried the time was running out. Her pastor says word of her safe recovery touched off a community celebration.
It's a time for us to be very, very glad that this girl was found alive.
Winter Springs Police Chief Kevin Brunel and his department will likely receive special recognition at the next city commission meeting. Nadia's rescuer sent a signal that was low tech but highly effective. This is Seminole County Sheriff's search video. A little shaky, but one thing stands out. Toilet paper strung across the trees. Yes, James King TP'd the forest and it worked. Soon as he carried Nadia out, a team of rescuers worked its way to help him out. A slow, meticulous process they felt was well worth the effort.
It's just a great day. It's a great ending. There's no other way to put it.
Medical teams waded into waist-deep water to put Nadia on a stretcher and bring her to safety.
Tonight, we believe Nadia has been transported to Arnold Palmer Children's Hospital. When she was first brought out of the woods, she was rushed to South Seminole Hospital in Longwood. Staff blocked the view with this sheet as she entered the hospital. Doctors say the most important thing was getting her fluids.
She clearly has had the effects of being outside now for about 5 days. She's got a lot of abrasions and bites and things that you'd expect, but she's handling it very, very well.
Doctors are expected to keep Nadia in the hospital overnight for evaluation. And West 2 has local live and late-breaking coverage of Nadia's rescue on our website. Just go to West.com. We are posting the complete 911 call from James King. There's also a spot where you can leave your messages for Nadia and her family.
A new tip and a new search in the case of missing Haley Cummings. Late-breaking details developing all night tonight. Chopper 2 up over a new search area in Putnam County as dive crews scoured the water. I want to give you a closer look at this area right now. This is just off Shell Harbor Road in Satsuma. That's the same town Haley disappeared from in February of last year. West 2's Kendra Astrike is live tonight in Satsuma. And Kendra, investigators pulled Misty out for more questioning.
Interviewed Haley's ex-stepmom, Misty, as well as the little girl's father. Nothing that they said, nor the tip investigators received to search down here in the river, have helped to find Haley, but the search isn't over yet.
It's very sad if that child has been here all of this time.
Right behind Kathy Goodson's house in the St. John's River near Satsuma is where dozens of divers are focused in the search for Haley Cummings.
No, we have not found him.
Putnam County Sheriff Jeff Hardy says a tip led them to scour the waterway and surrounding woods for hours Tuesday. Searchers say it isn't easy to see anything in the murky water. We're told they're using boxes to sift through the bottom.
Dark. I mean, there's no visibility.
Haley's paternal grandmother, Teresa Neves, left the sheriff's office in tears. She says with no closure and no comment. The sheriff called in Haley's mom and other family members to give them an update on the search. Detectives brought in Haley's father, Ronald Cummings, for questioning. He's in jail, as well as his ex-wife, Misty Croslin, her brother, Hank Croslin, and two others accused of drug trafficking, hydrocodone and oxycodone. Investigators questioned Croslin again today. She had been watching the five-year-old the night Haley vanished. Detectives believed all along she's hiding something. Search teams hope to uncover any new clue in the river.
I can't imagine that anyone would have put this whole community through this much trauma for this long, you know, if they really knew what had happened to that baby.
The sheriff won't say what they're looking for or who provided the tip. Investigators are securing the dock down here on Shell Harbor Road. Overnight, we're told the divers will be back out here in the morning at daybreak. Live in Satsuma in Putnam County, Kendra Astrike, West 2 News on CW 18.
A change of heart for millionaire murder suspect Bob Ward today.
Yeah, Ward was expected to ask a judge for permission to travel to his daughter's college graduation in Washington, D.C., but Ward decided he wouldn't go, and today's hearing was canceled. He's on home confinement, charged with the murder of his wife in their Isleworth mansion last year. New tonight, bad battery sent half a dozen people to the hospital. Rescuers got a call about a weird smell at the Advanced Auto Supply on State Street in Bunnell this afternoon. Those batteries were leaking. Several employees complained of headaches and nausea. They were checked out at the hospital and released.
Wish 2's 10 at 10 checking your weather right now with Chief Meteorologist Tony Manoffi and some scattered showers out there and a nice coastal breeze.
Feels really good out there. Well, let's track some of these showers, though, for everybody here south of downtown Orlando. We have three streamers. The main one just south of Orlando. We'll take a closer inspection of this particular little line of showers. Nothing significant, but enough to certainly dampen the roads. Again, from the airport on over towards Bay Lake and over towards just south of the beach line. There's some very heavy rain pushing at the southeastern Orange County. This will continue to hold together and impact the airport, we think, over the next half hour. So the wind is the big story. There's the breeze Martha was talking about. It's going to bring that onshore flow and keep the temperatures on the mild side. When will the showers go away? When will we heat up? Those answers, guys, straight ahead. See you in a few.
Tony, thanks. All new tonight, no mulligan for Tiger Woods. There's word that his marriage is over. Entertainment Tonight reports all efforts at a reconciliation with his wife, Elin, have broken down, and they'll soon be filing for divorce. Elin did not accompany Tiger to the Masters, and ET says the two do not communicate directly. She is 70 years young, not a day too old to rumble.
Yeah, local woman opens a can on a carjacker.
Trying to, at least, that's for sure.
Next at 10, a robber bails after a beatdown. Witnesses describe how one woman stopped a hijacking with a headlock.
Drifting away from daycare. Coming up, how two local children wandered astray and why the daycare is denying it.
Then, a late-breaking problem in space. The big issue now facing astronauts on board the ISS.
And a tot on a tightrope. It's video that'll have your head shaking in disbelief. This is Western News at 10 on CWA18.
A couple of thugs picked the wrong lady to mess with today.
I had no idea that this local 70-year-old woman had more fight than feeble in her.
She was putting items in her van at a Walmart in Daytona Beach when some teens pulled alongside. One jumped out and tried to steal her van, but she wasn't having it. She jumped in as the teen was driving away and started beating him. At one point, witnesses say she had him in a headlock, and she was definitely winning the fight.
Kicking his butt. Trying to, at least, that's for sure.
She was fighting with him.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
She won to an extent. When the teen couldn't take the beatdown anymore, he jumped out and took off, but police got a surveillance image of him right there at that Walmart, along with this man in the striped shirt and another man in a white tee who police think are part of a roving gang right there of car thieves. If you recognize these guys, you're being urged to call police right away.
Senate candidate Marco Rubio making a stop in Orlando today and sharing some harsh words for his opponent, Governor Charlie Crist. Rubio is particularly focused on a new ad that's being run by the Crist campaign. It mentions Rubio alongside his successor, Ray Sansom, who's under indictment for allegedly misspending tax dollars. Rubio says it makes him look like a criminal.
Here's the bottom line. It's wrong. I would never speak that way about another Republican. I think it's outrageous that he's doing that. But I guess he has the right to do with his money and his time as he chooses. You know, we've been 12 months into this campaign, and Charlie Crist has yet to make a single meaningful pronouncement on public policy.
Rubio has not been charged with any wrongdoing. A new poll shows that he is nearly 30 points ahead of Crist. Late-breaking Project Economy news tonight. One local school district is planning to hand out more than 100 pink slips this year, but none of those will go to teachers. Brevard County School Board members learned today the best case scenario will be 93 layoffs. The worst case, 162. Among the cuts will be a top-level administrator, an area superintendent. After-school care takes a big hit, and the district would go to four-day work weeks in the summer.
We have, at the district level, taken our district budget, gone line by line, project by project, department by department, seeing where we could cut pieces that don't directly affect the classroom.
School board members are expected to make their decision sometime this summer.
Some of the biggest names in space history are telling the president his plans for NASA just a bad idea. He's hearing from Apollo heroes to shuttle veterans. And on the Space Coast, people at the Space Walk of Fame Foundation are getting ready to wave signs and write letters. President Obama is visiting the Kennedy Space Center on Thursday to push his plan to end U.S. human spaceflight and encourage private industry to take over. Some residents say he won't be welcome.
I think it's going to be a waste of time. I think they're going to have all yes men there. There's not going to be any peons there that will tell him like it is.
President Obama's visit is Thursday afternoon. WESH 2 will have local live and late-breaking team coverage on a stop to the Space Coast. Watch it live on WESH and on WESH.com.
Meantime, there is one huge problem heating up on the International Space Station. The cooling system the astronauts just installed doesn't work, and it gets worse. If they don't fix it by the end of their mission, the ISS could overheat, forcing them to shut down most electronics. It would also cause major concern anytime they cross in the path of the sun.
Two little girls, about 3 years old, found wandering in a local neighborhood today.
Now, police are looking into whether the girls wandered from a daycare down the street.
Jill Sterling looked out the window of her Holly Hill home this morning and saw the unattended girls petting her dog. When she asked them where they lived, they said it was from across the street. But that home is abandoned. It
turns out local police say the girls wandered away from a daycare down the street licensed under the name Beautiful Beginnings. The woman who answered the door there says she doesn't know anything about it.
I don't know, but I'm going to go back in the house because I don't know what's going on.
Okay.
But it didn't happen. It didn't happen here.
Okay. Not so, say the cops. They say the woman admitted the girls got out through a back gate, a gate now being held shut by a cinder block.
A few rogue showers blasting up all across Central Florida.
And a nice breeze out there, yeah.
Yeah. I tell you what, I love the rain. You know, pollen, for me, I'm feeling a lot better. I don't know about you. You were struggling 2 weeks ago.
I've been pretty good the past two
see,
weeks.
We're getting out of the pollen, tree pollen season now because of the
rain.
You're
not going to ask about me? Or is it just
you're on vacation.
The two of you
you've got to be good coming back from vacation. Let's get into it. We're going to get in trouble here with her. Three streamers ongoing right now. One across Flagler County, one in Volusia County, and then the other one there, Northern Brevard County, Southern and Southeastern Orange County. Let's investigate this one first. Again, quick west to east flowing about 20 to 25 miles an hour here. There's 17. There's Bay Lake. There's the airport over towards Narcoosee. Some pretty good showers here. All, again, moving from west to east at about 20 to 25 miles an hour. And that extends farther to the east now, just to the south and west of Frontenac. There's the Cape. There's Cocoa Beach. A couple of showers here. And then we head a little bit farther to the north now into Volusia County. We do have some offshore showers just east of Edgewater. Those may hold together. And then farther to the north now, just north of Ormond by the Sea, over towards Flagler Beach and Palm Coast, a couple quick moving showers moving onshore at this hour. Look at the temps right now. Ocean water temps, upper 60s to near 70 degrees. And with that onshore flow, we're going to hold those temperatures in the upper 60s along the coast. Inland temperatures, however, will fall into the upper 50s, lower 60s from Orlando north and west. But again, from Titusville on south, mid to the upper 60s, one or two areas may even hold at around the 70-degree mark overnight tonight. Breezy conditions continue on Wednesday. Computer models are just having a hard time understanding what's going on here. The onshore flow picking up that moisture, and the models are not doing a very good job with it. And that's typical with this type of weather pattern in April. Now, the bigger concerns are along the coast. Winds northeast 15 to 25. Ocean water temperatures running 65 to 70. Rips a couple of showers tomorrow, but the rough seas are going to be the word for the next 48 hours, both Wednesday and again on Thursday. Offshore wave heights as high as 8 feet. Now, high temperatures tomorrow west of Sanford, low 80s. East of Sanford, we'll be holding in the mid to the upper 70s. We take a look at the longer range pattern. Still looks like a couple of showers there on Thursday, with high pressure building south. Southward, though, for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, it looks like drier and warmer weather conditions shall return to Central Florida. Having said that, then let's take a look now at that 7-day forecast. 20% chance for showers there on Wednesday and Thursday. Picture perfect for your TGI Friday as we head into the upcoming weekend. Jim and Martha, nice 83.
Tony, thank you. Dangling a 3-year-old.